My name is Brodie Miller. I'm a veterinarian with Texas Animal Health Commission, and I want to thank the Extension Service and Live Oak County Fair Association for hosting this for y'all. I also want to thank Live Oak County, the county judge, county commissioners. We've been really blessed to work with a really good county, so my compliments to y'all. We've had the unfortunate experience to have to work through similar situations in other counties, and it's always difficult to try and get some of the infrastructure in place to help with the process, and your county commissioners have done a bang-up job, so I wanted to recognize them. Also, we've got Dr. Andy Schwartz over here. He's the executive director of Texas Animal Health Commission. He's our state veterinarian here. Dr. Brian Bowl is in the background. Some of you may have spoken with him. He's our epidemiologist. He's also a veterinarian. He works out of our Beeville office as well. Dexter Sumter, who is probably who most of you speak with, he's my right-hand man in the field as far as getting the work scheduled to get cattle and horses worked, and main point of contact right now in the field. And then Bart Stockbridge back there, he's helping us a lot with some of what we call trace work, which we'll get to in the presentation. And then Thomas Swafford is here from our public information office. He brought all the educational materials, which can be really helpful. So I just want to try to make clear on what the intent of tonight's meeting is. It's always good at the beginning of this process that we're going to go through together to try and make sure we've got good information, some facts, a basic understanding of cattle fever ticks and their life cycle, their biology, and how it relates to why we do what we do within the eradication program. I think there can be a lot of confusion. It's a really complicated issue to understand and to explain. But sometimes if you do have an understanding of the why behind the what, it makes a lot more sense. So that's the intent of it, is an educational meeting. I welcome your questions for clarification on anything. If you do have any issues that you want to bring up not related to understanding the program or the life cycle of the tick, I'd be glad to entertain those one-on-one at any time. So, you know, if you have a complaint or you've got a unique set of circumstances at your place that we need to figure out how to work through, you know, let's do that later one-on-one, but make sure everybody has a good understanding of how we got here and then where we're going to go going forward. So I've worked for Texas Animal Health Commission for 3 years this month. So my background, I graduated from A&M. School of Veterinary Medicine, and I was in large animal practice in Stephenville, Texas for my entire career up until 3 years ago. So that's what my background is in, a lot of dairy cattle work up there, beef cattle, and equine as well. So I'm going to do my best to explain about fever ticks and about the eradication program. Like I said, it's complicated and it's difficult to understand, but I think there's some key concepts that if you've got those, I think you can figure out some of the details as well. Now, I'm not an entomologist. There are things I don't know about insects and ticks, but there's some basic principles, like I said, that make some of what we do make sense. So we'll start off real basic. What is a cattle fever tick? So that's a picture of some right there on an animal. We have two species of fever tick in Texas. One we call annulatus, and one is called microplus. This is really important. Keep that in mind. This is one of those concepts. This will be important later on when we talk about how we may do some things differently in some areas of Texas. And so annulatus is one species that survives in more dry and cool climates. We have that tick when it comes into Texas from Mexico, generally from Laredo north to Del Rio. You get much north of Del Rio and they just don't survive well, but that's their established range. You get south of Laredo, from there to Brownsville, and you have the more tropical cattle fever tick, which is microplus. That's the tick that we have here in Live Oak County in the current outbreak. And so sometimes the tick that you have can determine some of what you do and what tools you use for eradication. So we're worried about it because of the threat that it poses to the cattle industry, not only in Texas, but the United States. There's a close-up picture of one, And it's a very distinct tick. If you've had any cattle inspected and you've seen them collect ticks and maybe pull out a little magnifying glass and look, there's some little anatomical differences, especially up here on the head, that we're looking for. If you just hold two ticks side by side in your hand, they can look very similar, but we're looking for some very specific characteristics to say, is this a fever tick or not a fever tick? But that's a good close-up picture of one. So this is why we're concerned about this particular tick, because it's a vector, it's an insect that can carry and transmit a disease called babesiosis. Almost all animals have their own specific variants of babesiosis, and cattle have one called Babesia bovis. There's a couple of others, but this is the one we're most concerned about. And this tick can carry this particular organism. It's a protozoa. It gets in the bloodstream, it destroys red blood cells. The cattle typically die basically from anemia. You may have seen cattle with anaplasmosis before. It's a similar disease in the way that it behaves. And it's fatal in most cases when it's introduced into a naive population of cattle. And what I mean by that is a group of cattle that have never been exposed to the disease and have no immunity to it. So this is kind of the scenarios you can run into. This is a cow that's pretty heavily infested with cattle fever ticks. And if you have a naive population of cattle, which we do here, and you have the fever tick and you have babesia, you can get a babesiosis outbreak and suffer some pretty significant death losses in your cattle herd. Right now we have a group of naive cattle here and we have the fever tick, but we do not have babesiosis, okay? We don't have a babesiosis outbreak here, we have a cattle fever tick outbreak here. And that's important to distinguish that. I think sometimes people kind of overlap those when in their thinking about it, okay? Every time we have a cattle fever tick outbreak, it doesn't necessarily mean that they're carrying this organism. We test them, we test the ticks, we pull blood on some of the cattle, we check to see, do we have babesiosis circulating in this population of ticks? And we don't here, thankfully. That could change at any minute if these ticks come into contact with Mexican origin cattle. We import close to 1 million head a year of Mexican origin cattle into Texas. And so about 50% of them carry this Babesia organism. Now, they've grown up with it their whole life. They've developed some immunity to it. So you don't have big die-offs of cattle in Mexico from babesiosis. They're carriers. They're basically the reservoir of the disease. And so when we have a cattle fever tick outbreak, even though it may not be carrying this particular organism, if the tick and these cattle cross paths, that could change. So it's very important to try and get the tick eradicated before something like this happens. So as far as the history of the cattle fever tick eradication program, This is kind of where we started out back in the late 1800s, early 1900s. Everything you see shaded in blue, cattle fever ticks were established. And most of the cattle in those areas were kind of like the cattle in Mexico are today. They had babesiosis. They were exposed to it from a young age, they developed some immunity, and they were carriers, kind of like Mexico is. So basically, in effect, that the top of that line was kind of like the Rio Grande is today. So, but you go north of that and fever ticks can't survive long term. If ticks get carried into that area during the right time of year under the right environmental conditions, they can absolutely survive and cause all kinds of problems. But they're not gonna become established long term above that blue line because of the environmental conditions. It gets too cold, too dry, etc. And we talked about the two species, you remember, Microplus and Annulatus. This is just fever ticks in general. Microplus tends to stay a little closer to the coast, and Annulatus is the one that survived in the northernmost areas of those blue areas. So why was it a big deal? Why was it a problem? When did they decide we need to do something about it? And that's in the late 1800s, early 1900s, is when cattle drives started happening, taking all the cattle out of South Texas and the southern states and taking them into these northern states to the railheads so they could go to the slaughter plants and feed all the people. And so what happened was our cattle who were carrying the disease and the tick, but they were immune to it, When they crossed over that into these areas where it was a naive population of cattle, those ticks would drop off, lay eggs, they would hatch. Those infected larvae would crawl on their cattle, and you'd have up to 90% death losses. So they didn't really understand the science behind it or the biology of it, but they knew that Texas cattle, when they came through, a few weeks later, all their cattle started dying. And that's where the name came from, Texas cattle fever. And so it wasn't long before they started meeting us at the border with shotguns and wouldn't let our cattle come through their state. And so we had way more cattle in Texas than we had people to eat those cattle. We needed a market for those cattle. And so in 1893, the governor formed what is now Texas Animal Health Commission. At the time, it was a Livestock Sanitary Commission, with one goal, which was to figure out what the tick problem was and fix it, deal with it. So there was a choice, basically. Are we going to try to eradicate babesiosis or try to eradicate the fever tick? And the choice was to eradicate the fever tick because there's some key things about its biology that make us able to do that and try to maintain it as eradicated. So they started the National Fever Tick Eradication Campaign. And by 1943, you can see all of that's turned yellow. They had eradicated cattle fever ticks from the United States. Unfortunately, lucky for us in South Texas, right here from Del Rio down to Brownsville, in Mexico, those ticks are still established. They do not have an eradication program, so we still have an area where we're constantly re-exposed to cattle fever ticks from wildlife coming from Mexico across the Rio Grande and stray livestock coming across the Rio Grande. And so we, in effect, became the gatekeepers from Del Rio to Brownsville for the rest of the country to try and protect the U.S. cattle industry from cattle fever ticks and babesiosis. So we established, there's the quarantine line in 1912. So everything below that line, all those people were basically having to undergo the same exact restrictions as ranchers within this quarantine area here. You couldn't move any cattle out of any of those states north of that line without having them inspected and dipped. And everybody south of that line were gathering all their cattle and dipping them on a regular schedule, trying to eradicate ticks. So you can see where we started and where we've come. So in order to try and maintain the rest of the country as free, knowing that Mexico has an established population of ticks that are constantly going to re-expose us from Del Rio down to Brownsville, we established a permanent quarantine zone along the river that acts as a buffer zone to try and protect the rest of Texas and the United States from incursions of cattle fever ticks. So that's kind of an overview of it, about 580 river miles. And it varies in width. They try to use roads where possible to define where the zone is and where it's not. It's easier for people to know if they're in or they're out. And that's what it looks like. Here's a close-up view of it. It's split up into different work areas. And each work area has a county office, and they have mounted patrol inspectors that work their area of the Rio Grande and take care of all the herds within that permanent quarantine zone. So these ranchers that ranch here, they've been under the same restrictions that are in this quarantine circle now for a long time and will be forever. It's a permanent buffer zone until something changes on the other side of the river. So this is another really important concept. Let me back up once. I want you to remember this because I mentioned earlier some of the tools that we have in this program are appropriate to use in an area like this because you have constant ticks being carried in forever, as long until Mexico does something. That's a different scenario from when you find ticks here, carried up here and dropped here, and you're not going to get constant pressure of more introduction of ticks. So It may be a little bit different strategically in how you look at it. This is a buffer zone. This is an outbreak that we want to get cleared up, make sure we have no more fever ticks and go away and be done with it and go back to normal life. Here, you have permanent controls in place. So regardless of the kind of ticks that are coming across, any livestock in that area are always going to be inspected and dipped before they leave. So there is a difference just because you have a cattle fever tick infestation down on the river, it's a little bit different scenario than if you have one up here. So this is another important concept, a host. These are some of the hosts. It's not all inclusive, but these are the more common ones that we see. When I say a host, what I mean is an animal that a cattle fever tick can get on as a larvae or a seed tick, attach and be able to complete its life cycle, become an adult, drop off, lay eggs, start a new generation of ticks. And this is one of the unique things about this particular tick, which is part of the reason of why we can eradicate it. Not everything is a suitable host for this tick. Things like people, feral swine, dogs, cats, rabbits, coyotes, birds are not a suitable host for this tick. They're not going to contribute to the spread of this tick, establishment of new infestations, or maintenance or perpetuation of an existing infestation. Cattle are probably the most suitable or efficient host. That means when cattle fever tick larvae crawl on cattle, they do really well. They can multiply exponentially. Very good at completing their life cycle on cattle. Nilgai are also very good hosts. You can find them very heavily infested. Deer, horses are hosts, probably not as good as cattle and nilgai. May have something to do with their grooming habits, who knows. But they are hosts. So deer are not going to get babesiosis from the ticks and die like cattle will. That babesiosis is specific to cattle. There's nothing about it that makes the meat unsafe to eat, is going to make deer sick, is going to hurt a human, anything like that. I want to be clear about that. The main problem we have with deer is that they can transport this tick. So they can contribute to the spread of infestations, and then it can also maintain this tick on a premises and keep an infestation going that we're trying to clean up. So these are hosts. So here's Texas, here's Mexico. That is an ineffective tick barrier. So, you know, I want to say something because I've been through this a couple of times in different areas of the state, and at the beginning, people generally are always looking for someone to blame as far as why did this happen? Whose fault is it? And more often than not, it's nobody's fault. People doing just normal business, normal ranching, a lot of different possibilities, and just by bad luck, a tick got carried up here and dropped and got it started. Nobody did anything wrong. But if you do want to blame someone, George Strait wrote a song, Blame It on Mexico, if you need a reason, because that's where the ticks are established and that's where we get them introduced into Texas from. So what do we do to try to prevent stuff like this from happening? The Cattle Fever Tick Eradication Program is a federal program under the USDA. So they have the USDA Tick Force. Some of you guys may have heard about these guys, Mounted Patrol Inspectors. Some people call them tick riders. So they have an assigned area of river that they ride each day horseback with a bulletproof vest and a sidearm. And their job is to apprehend any stray Mexican livestock that cross the river. They've got a tough job. They come across some interesting things down there. Pretty dangerous job. But they do it every day. They're rough and tough guys, but they're good guys. And they work their tails off to try and keep fever ticks out of the United States. They also work all the herds in that permanent quarantine zone. As you can imagine, it's not uncommon for them to become infested with cattle fever ticks. So the ranchers down there have been with it for a long time, but they may get cleaned up for a little while and next year they're infested again. And so the Mounted Patrol Inspectors also work all these herds to try and get those pastures eradicated from fever ticks. They also conduct all the routine inspections and dippings to move cattle and horses out of the quarantine zone. So they stay pretty busy. We also have veterinarians at the port. The Mexican cattle that do come into the country all have to be inspected tick-free and dipped before they're allowed to come in. We also have our state inspectors that work the sale barns, and they are involved in a lot of different disease programs, but they're also trying their best to look for ticks that are on the cattle, trying to pull those ticks, identify them, make sure we're not moving fever ticks through the markets. So they do the river and range inspections like we mentioned, all the movement controls and treatments. They apprehend stray animals. And I also want to mention That we also have another partner within USDA called ARS, or Agricultural Research Service. They have a cattle fever tick research lab in Mission at Moorefield Air Base. And this is our pipeline for eradication tools. Texas Animal Health Commission doesn't have research scientists studying new tools or new drugs. So we have to rely on the researchers. So this is where our products and our tools come from that we can use that are appropriate eradication tools. An eradication program is a lot different than a control program. And so you got to have pretty stringent requirements before something works appropriately as an eradication tool. There are a lot of things that could work as a control tool, but the goal is eradication of the tick, especially up in the free area like this, where we want to get it cleaned up, release everything from quarantine, and go on our merry way and back to normal life. And so Agricultural Research Services are the ones that we ask them to please look at this product or look at this product, or and they're doing all sorts of things that are interesting and kind of crazy sometimes. You think they're looking at parasitic wasps that lay their eggs inside an adult female fever tick when she drops on the ground that they have in other countries. They're looking at certain nematodes that control the carrizo cane down on the river, which is a great environment for the tick. They're looking at some of the products that are used as dewormers and pesticide treatments on cattle in other countries that we may not have here. And it takes a long time to run a product through all of its paces to see, is this going to be an appropriate eradication tool? And but they're the guys that give us new tools. So for forever, the only tool we had was Kumafos or Coral and a dipping vat. But they gave us a new tool some years ago that we now use that's an appropriate eradication tool called Doramectin or Dectamax. When used properly, it can also effectively eradicate ticks off a pasture. And that's good because that helps ease the burden on the rancher. He doesn't have to gather his cattle as often. Hopefully there's more products in the pipeline to make that even less burdensome should a rancher find himself under a quarantine infested with fever ticks. So Texas Animal Health Commission, what is our part in this? Because they operate in the state of Texas, they operate under our authority and under our rules. So we help write and maintain the cattle fever tick eradication program rules and regulations. We have 13 commissioners appointed by the governor from each facet of industry that have input on that. And then we also have a cattle fever tick working group that's made up of scientists, as well as veterinarians, as well as ranchers and producers, industry leaders, and they give their input because some of the rules that were written a long time ago, the cattle industry has changed a lot. We do business a little different than we used to. And so this is something that while we still need to maintain an eradication focus and mindset, that we need to make sure that we stay up to date with how we're doing things appropriate to how the industry works. So we make an effort to do that. We do a lot of what we call trace work. So when we have to go find out where people sold cattle, we assist with that. Also, we typically will provide support personnel to help them go work cattle herds and things like that. When you have an outbreak this far north of the river, it's impractical for the USDA to come up here, it's so far away, and manage it. And so we've almost kind of flopped or reversed roles here where it's up here, so we're managing this outbreak, but now USDA will send a couple of people when we need them to help us out, boots on the ground. So this is a common misperception. A lot of people say you can't eradicate. How do you eradicate ticks? You know, they're all over the place. And that's true. That's a key point that I want you to think of. This is an environmental problem, not an animal problem. We're talking about the ticks, not the disease, babesiosis, but just cattle fever ticks, okay? A lot of us, if you went through the brucellosis days, you have a mindset of an animal with a disease, and that's what you're focused on. That's actually a lot easier to deal with because a disease like brucellosis in a cow has a very set incubation time. If you have a brucellosis positive herd, I can come test your herd, remove the positive animals, wait 120 days, test the rest of your herd. If they're negative, we're done. Pretty simple. It's a disease that the animal's carrying that we can do a definitive test for. I can pull blood on her and say, do you have it or not? This is an environmental problem that has a lot of variables. Temperature, humidity, vegetation, environment, etc., has ways to spread it throughout the environment. And then trying to detect whether or not there are cattle fever ticks on this pasture can be difficult. There's no good way to go out into a vacant pasture and tell if there's cattle fever ticks there. You have to have hosts that we talked about, like deer, nilgai, or cattle, or horses, on the pasture for a long enough time that the ticks will get on them, grow to a stage where you can see them or feel them to be able to tell if there's ticks there. So you've got to be able to use animals to find out if there's ticks in the environment. Whole different ball game than an animal with a disease like brucellosis. So all ticks basically have three life stages. One is called a larvae. That's what we call seed ticks. I don't know if you've ever seen them. You can almost not even see them. Little bitty things. But if you've ever walked through a seed bed of ticks, you may have seen them on your socks or something like that. Well, this particular tick is what we call a one-host tick. That doesn't mean it only feeds on cattle. What it means is when it gets on a suitable host as a larvae, it's going to stay on that host all the way until it's done. It's an adult and it drops off and it lays eggs. That's very different than most of the ticks you'll find on your dog or maybe find on you. Those ticks typically use three hosts to complete their life cycle. So they're on an animal, they're off in the environment. They're on an animal, they're off in the environment. Then they're back on an animal. It's not the way this tick works, and it's another unique characteristic, which is part of the reason why we can't eradicate it from the environment. So all of them will go from a larvae to a nymph to an adult. Those are the three life stages. This tick does it all on one host. And then when it takes a blood meal as an adult and engorges, it drops off and it lays eggs in the environment. The time that this critter spends in the environment is way longer than the time it spends on the host, which is another thing that makes it difficult. In order to clean it up from the environment, we've got to treat the host while the ticks are on it. And that'll become apparent as we go on. If you're going to take a picture of any slide or try to burn anything into your memory, this is it. So, you know, people say, why does this quarantine last so long? Why does it take so long to figure out if I've got ticks or not? And this is a big part of why. Again, it's an environmental problem, and the only way to tell if there's ticks in the environment are to look at the hosts that are on that environment. So, first of all, when that engorged female tick, y'all remember the picture at the beginning with all those big ticks hanging on that cow? It's an engorged female. She's about ready to drop off and lay eggs. They'll lay up to 4,400 eggs. She may take up to 39 days before she even decides to lay eggs. It may take her 4 to 44 days to complete laying eggs. So even if a tick dropped off in your pasture a month and a half ago, we're going to go scratch your cattle and they're going to be clean. She may not have even laid eggs yet, but your pasture's infested, okay? She's out there. Once she does lay eggs, depending on the environmental conditions, it can take up to almost 5 months for those to even hatch. So those eggs are not going to crawl on an animal. We're not going to find the eggs in the environment. So even if it was 5 months ago that a deer came across your property and dropped an adult female fever tick, and we come to inspect your cattle today and they're clean, it doesn't necessarily mean that the pasture's clean. This is why it takes time. It takes multiple inspections over time to determine the fever tick status of the pasture because it's an environmental problem and it has so many environmental variables. Once they do hatch, I'm going to kind of skip down to the bottom. When the eggs hatch into larvae, look down here at the bottom. That little cluster of 4,000 larvae, they can lay there in the pasture under the right environmental conditions for almost 9 months without a blood meal, waiting for a host to walk by. So you can see how this is a pretty extended time period that the life cycle of this tick can take place in the environment. So here's what we're more focused on with the treatment of the cattle is when they get on the animal. So when they get on the animal, 7 to 12 days for the larvae to attach, engorge, and molt into a nymph. 5 to 17 days for those nymphs to engorge, molt into an adult, and then 5 to 23 days for the adults to engorge. So the average, this is key, from the time that larvae crawls on the cow to go through, become an adult, drop off, and lay eggs, is 18 to 37 days, an average of 25 days. But they can do it as quickly as 18 days. And then they may be in the environment for 9 months. But they're on that cow for 18 days. That's our shot to kill it, okay, is when it's on the animal. That's our best shot. And so this is really, really important, because if you know this, if you know the life cycle, you can figure out how to break it. And you can set up a program to eradicate this type of pest from the environment. So that's engorged females ready to drop off. They're going to drop off, and every single one of those is going to lay about 4,000 eggs. And they're going to drop off at different times in different spots of the pasture and kind of distribute those all over the premises. And, you know, if you're rotating your cattle to different pastures, you can see how this can pretty rapidly spread through there. Once they drop off, they're going to lay eggs. That's what an adult fever tick female looks like when she's laying eggs. We call that an egg mass. So there's the 4,000 eggs. And after she completes that, she's going to die. She's done. But now there's a new generation that comes on. That egg mass staying together is pretty important. That's a little microenvironment that's important to their survival. They are susceptible to desiccation or drying out and extreme temperatures at this stage in their life when they're in the environment. So if this egg mass gets scattered all over the place, it's probably not going to survive very long. If it's on this concrete, it's probably not going to do very well. If it is extremely dry and gets extremely cold for an extended period of time, it's going to do some damage, especially to the eggs on the outside of this mass. But you still may have some on the inside that have been insulated that are good to go. So this is when they can be susceptible to some environmental factors. Once they decide to hatch, and you remember that can be almost 5 months, right, depending on the environmental conditions. Once they decide to hatch, they become larvae. I don't know how well y'all can see those, but those are fever tick larvae on a sock. The guy's holding them there. Really tiny. So this is another common question we get. Well, you scratched my cattle, you inspected my cattle, and you didn't find anything. Why do I still have to dip them? And we're not going to find these on cattle. These could be attached to your cattle, and you're not going to see them, you're not going to feel them. They're so small. And so if your cattle did have these attached and we didn't dip them and you carried them to your ranch over in Bee County, 18 days later, she's going to look like that picture of that cow a minute ago. So that's one of the reasons why, even though the cattle were inspected clean, we're still going to treat them before they leave. We want to prevent movement of these guys. That's a pretty good reference. That's all three life stages side by side. These are almost impossible to detect when you're inspecting cattle. These are actually, that's a little deceptive. Those are really small too. They're really hard. That's a nymph. They're hard to find as well, especially if you've got some pretty snorty cattle that are trying to kick your head off or break your arm while you're trying to inspect them, piling up on top of each other. You're trying to get them through so they don't hurt each other. You're doing the best inspection you can. Y'all have probably seen that. So if you've got just a few nymphs on your cattle, there's a chance that could go undetected. Most often when we find a new infestation, it's because we found some adults. Those are the easiest ones to find. Those are the ones you can typically see, or if it's tucked up in a flank, you can generally feel them pretty easy. And so I want to make that point, because sometimes we may find only one adult tick on 100 head of cattle. You think, well, that's the only tick that's there. But I guarantee if we found one of those on 100 head of cattle, there's a ton of those all over them that we didn't feel, and there's probably a lot of those that we didn't find. So I want to just give you the simplest scenario possible to understand how you eradicate ticks on a premises that has fever ticks on it. And if you understand the simplest scenario, I think then it'll make sense how some other factors can complicate that and delay things or hurt your progress, or how you can be successful even if you have other variables in there. But this is the simplest scenario. So if you have a pasture And it has no other hosts on it. No deer, no nilgai, no nothing. Just a 100-acre pasture, coastal field, wide open, and you have cattle on it at a good stocking rate, and you have fever ticks on it. If you know that it takes at least minimum of 18 days for that tick to complete its life cycle, and you know that the unfed larvae out there in the grass waiting for a host can survive up to 9 months, well, if you take the cattle and you turn them out, they're the best host, right? Ticks like to get on them, and you use them like a sponge or a mop. They graze over the entire pasture, and the little fever tick larvae crawl on them. If you bring them up on day 14 and run them through a dipping vat and kill all the ticks that are on them, none of those ticks had an opportunity to make it to day 18, complete their life cycle, and make a new generation of ticks. So if you do that, dip every head every 14 days for 9 months, I'm going to say 9 months, that's typically what we talk about, and at that point, at the end of 9 months, you've either harvested all the fever ticks on the premises with the cattle, using them like a sponge, and you've dipped them and killed the ticks, or if there's a little seed bed of ticks out there that for whatever reason the cattle did not go through and pick up, they've starved to death because they can only survive 9 months without a blood meal. So if you have this scenario, which is the simplest scenario there is, you're going to have success. You will have eradicated fever ticks on that pasture. And in fact, if you think about it, and this what people used to do a long time ago, and it was somewhat effective in some instances, you could take the cattle off the pasture for 9 months, and all the fever tick larvae out there would just starve to death if you had no other host there for them to complete their life cycle on. So why was the program so effective at eradicating fever ticks from 13 states from 1907 to 1943? If you think about it, we also had screw worms at that time. Some of you may be familiar with that. The deer density in South Texas was very, very low. So there weren't a lot of hosts other than cattle. We had a lot of cattle in South Texas, very few deer, and no nilgai, really. And so we had this simple scenario that we're talking about. There's a pasture, that's the simple scenario, there's fever ticks, those little fever tick larvae waiting for a host to come by, and the only host that's on there are cattle, and they're being treated systematically for 9 months to break the tick's life cycle and eradicate ticks. So people would vacate pastures back then if there were no deer around. You could do that for 9 months, all the ticks would die. You could come back in with cattle, no problem, the ticks are gone. That's changed a lot. As y'all know, the demographics in South Texas have changed a lot. We have a lot less cattle herds. We have a lot more deer. Once we eradicated the screwworm, the deer density went way up, especially in counties like Zapata County, Starr County. The use of the land has gone, in a lot of instances, from ranching with cattle to recreational uses. And so, again, I said the only way you can tell if there's ticks on a premises are to inspect the hosts that are on that premises. If you remove half the cattle from half the premises down here, you've lost half of your read on the environment, if that makes sense. If you've got cattle on every place and you're inspecting stuff regularly, you detect a new infestation pretty quick. But if we've got miles and miles of premises with no cattle, an infestation can be moved by wildlife a long ways before it finally shows up. So that can be frustrating. So this is the simplest scenario. If you understand that, then you can understand the complicating factor. So you throw deer into the mix here, which is the case nowadays. Most places do have some white-tailed deer on them. They are an appropriate host for cattle fever ticks. So if this fever tick larvae up here crawls on a deer that's not getting dipped every 14 days, 18 days later, it's going to complete its life cycle, lay 4,000 eggs, and start a new generation of ticks. So we have to figure out a way to treat the deer as well while we're using the cattle as a tool to mop up the ticks. If you have nilgai antelope is a big challenge down in Cameron and Willacy County, and they're even more of a difficult challenge than deer, but they're also a good host for cattle fever ticks. Also, if you are this rancher right here, and say you have your ranch here split up into six different pastures, and you don't really like to put your cattle down here in this pasture because it's real brushy and they're hard to gather, so you don't ever really let them in there. If there's fever ticks in there and there's deer, you're not going to get those ticks cleaned up with the cattle. You don't know where the ticks are on the property, so you got to use the cattle like a mop or a sponge on the whole thing, into every little corner. So it can become pretty complex pretty quickly to try and eradicate ticks, especially now that we've got more significant wildlife components to it. So what are the treatment options that we use? I referenced in the simple scenario dipping cattle every 14 days. That's how the program started and was for years. I mentioned Agricultural Research Service is the one that gives us new tools. They gave us Doramectin. So in that instance, the rancher, instead of dipping his cattle every 14 days, he's only having to pin them every 25 to 28 days, and we're giving them an injection for 9 months. And so that still seems like a lot, but it's only half of the gatherings of what he was having to do. So it's a big improvement. And hopefully we'll have even better products coming. So some of you may have seen this. This is a spray box. It's typically what we use to treat cattle with Coral in lieu of a dipping vat. When we don't have a vat in the area ready to go, we have no choice but to use a spray box. We like to use a dipping vat. When they go in through a full immersion swim vat, when they get out, there's no dry area left on their body. Fever ticks like to go to the warm, soft areas of the skin, like way up in the armpits, front flanks, and the rear flanks. Even using a spray box, they can come out with some dry spots on them. If you ever try to hand spray one, even as good as you think you're gonna do on an animal that's in a chute moving around, if you were to knock that animal down and roll him up on his back and look, you're going to have some dry spots. So these are the type of treatment modalities that we use when we're using Coral or Kumafos on cattle. Unless it's a horse, halter broke horse, or a halter broke show steer that will stand really still, that you can get up under in every nook and cranny with a hand sprayer, we will effectively hand spray those types of animals. So we use a lot of Dectamax now. We use spray boxes at the beginning of an outbreak till we have a dipping vat to be able to move cattle. Once we have a vat, that's what we use. And of course, you'll hear terminology like scratching, and that's what we do when we inspect for ticks. We're visibly looking for ticks, like the picture you saw earlier. That was pretty obvious. So we'll pull any ticks that we see to see if we can identify them as a fever tick or not a fever tick. But we're also physically scratching the animals up in the flanks and under the belly, because some of those ticks you can't see, they'll hide up in those little nooks and crannies. So what do we do about the deer? If you have an infested premises and you're treating the cattle, but you have deer on it. So this is a tool, another one that ARS provided us with. It's a certain formulation of Ivermectin-treated corn that we can put out after deer season. And we're the ones actually that will come out and put up these feeders and these little hog excluder fences and keep the feeders full. And so the deer consume the corn. Hopefully they consume enough to get blood levels adequate to kill fever ticks. And if you're using the cattle to clean up the fever ticks and you're treating the deer, you've got a pretty good chance at eradicating ticks on that premises. It's not ideal because you have to depend on the deer to medicate themselves. It's called an indirect treatment. We're not dipping the deer and giving them a direct treatment, or injecting the deer and giving them a direct treatment. We're depending on them to consume sufficient quantities to medicate themselves adequately. But if you can get enough of them doing it in an area and you've got cattle systematically mopping up those ticks, you'll have success. We do stop feeding this 60 days prior to hunting season because there is a meat withdrawal time on it. So that is another one of the drawbacks. It's not a treatment that we can do year round. But it's the best we've got right now for white-tailed deer. So there is another product that we started using down in that permanent quarantine zone this past fall. And a lot of people refer to it as the fever tick vaccine. It's BM86 immunomodulator. And it was a vaccine developed in some of the Latin countries, in Cuba. And Dr. Schwartz and his cohorts with USDA have jumped through all kinds of hoops for years to try and get this here. There's a lot of even regulatory hoops that we have to jump through as an agency to try and get products that are not approved for use in this country able to be put in our tool belt to use. And so this is the fever tick vaccine. Basically, what it does is you vaccinate cattle. She makes antibodies that are specific for the fever tick. When the tick latches on and takes a blood meal, the antibodies in the cow's bloodstream complex with a protein in the fever tick's gut, and it damages that tick. It can kill them or damage them to the point where they can't lay eggs. So this is very promising. It has about a 99% efficacy against annulatus. Now that's an eradication tool. Something with a 99% efficacy is an eradication tool. Remember we talked about eradication versus control? But do you also remember what kind of tick we're dealing with here in Live Oak County? It's Microplus. So it has about a 45% efficacy against Microplus. That's more of a control tool, okay? And there's appropriate places for tools like that. Again, it damages the tick gut. You have to give a dose of this vaccine, get the cattle back up in 28 days and give a booster, and then vaccinate them every 6 months, the entire time that they're going to be on the program. The efficacy starts out at 45%. They do say that there's a cumulative effect. So you will get better efficacy against Microplus as you go on. In other words, if a cow on your pasture has had the two initial doses and been vaccinated every 6 months for 2 years, then that efficacy is going to be much higher than 45%. There is a 60-day slaughter withdrawal on this. So that can also make it challenging for people that want to market their cattle when you're having to observe a 60-day withdrawal time. So real quick, and we'll circle back around to some of these things. The terminology can be confusing. I want to go over what the types of quarantines are. So some of you here probably were issued a quarantine, handed a quarantine, and it has some boxes on there. There's four different types. This is where it can get it confusing. So an infested quarantine just means a premises where we found cattle fever ticks, okay? It has some different requirements than some of the other quarantines. An exposed quarantine, that means an animal from an infested premises has gotten over onto this premises and exposed it. One of those big ticks could have dropped off into this premises and now it's an infested. So we call that exposed. We haven't found fever ticks there, but there's a high likelihood that they're there because an animal from an infested property got over there. The requirements for those two are very similar. On both of those, you see where I say systematic treatment required. That's the scenario we talked about just a second ago, where you dip the cattle every 14 days for 9 months, or we inject them every 25 to 28 days for 9 months. That's systematic treatment. That's required on an infested or an exposed, because you're trying to eradicate the ticks that you know are there. Also on those premises, because they're much higher risk, we do restrict movement of hay off those premises, any earth-moving equipment. You know, we saw that fever tick that had dropped off and laid all those eggs. That egg mass that may take up to 4 months to hatch, if you scatter that all over the place, they're going to dry out and not survive. But if you have a backhoe that picked up a big intact piece of vegetation with an egg mass on it and then came over to your ranch and it dropped off, that's still viable, and that could have moved an infestation. So we do restrict hay, equipment, stuff like that off of infested and exposed premises. The next one is called an adjacent quarantine. All that means is that you're fence line adjacent to either an infested or an exposed. The next is called a check quarantine. That means you're in the quarantine area, but you're not infested, you're not exposed, and you're not adjacent. That's kind of everybody else. That's supposed to be our kind of safety buffer, right? All the quarantines, So for an adjacent or a check quarantine, we come and do an initial herd inspection to determine the fever tick status of the pasture or the environment. And then after that, we try to inspect the herd about every 90 days so that if a new infestation pops up, we detect it early. For all the quarantines, it does require inspection and treatment of livestock or deer or hides moving off the premises. That's everybody. And that goes back to that picture of that sock with those little larval fever ticks. If a new infestation has just gotten started and we've got fever tick larvae on an animal, we don't want to take the risk of moving that somewhere. So that's why we go ahead and treat those livestock before they leave. So I kept saying 9 months, and I'm trying to simplify things a little bit. So on infested and exposed, we do systematic treatment for 6 to 9 months. We have a table that the smart entomologist guys made, and it's based off of the fact that in the spring you get a big bloom of ticks, and in the fall you get a big bloom of ticks, in the winter you have suppression of ticks. So there are some of those infested or exposed quarantines where we only need to systematically treat for 6 months. And that's because the environmental conditions aren't conducive to survival of those larvae in the pasture for 9 months, which is the extreme. Most times it ends up being 9 months though. So if you're one of those that's infested or exposed, we've treated your cattle for 9 months systematically. When we're done, you become a check premises, just like everybody else in the circle, for another 6 months. So what that means, you can do the math, is best case scenario in a very simple, small outbreak is 12 to 15 months before release of quarantine totally of the premises. And generally, when we have what we call a control purpose quarantine area, which is what this is, we will release the whole thing at once. We don't release individual premises a little here, a little there, a little there. We make sure we've got all the ticks cleaned up, they haven't spread, and we release everybody at once. So that's how it goes. So factors that can affect release, and this is another important concept I really want y'all to understand, because this is truly a community problem. When you have an area like this with so many ranchers under quarantine, many people, often the first response I get when I talk to somebody is, I don't have any cattle. It's an environmental problem, okay? And so when we start out and we quarantine an area and I'm looking at all the premises in that area, every single one of them has a big question mark for me. Have fever ticks spread to this premises yet? And it's my job and your job to try and answer those question marks over the 12 to 16 months. And the only way to answer it is with having hosts on the premises inspected for ticks. That's the only way we can tell if there's ticks there or not. And so there are a lot of factors that can affect the release of the quarantine area. So late treatments. So if you're under an infested quarantine and we're getting your cattle up every 25 to 28 days to inject them, trying to break that fever tick's life cycle or dipping every 14 days, and those cattle go late without a treatment, fever ticks can cycle on them, start a new generation. That can delay things, okay? Because if a tick ever cycles, even 2 months into the systematic treatment, lays eggs in those hatch, now that new batch of larvae can survive from 9 months until then. So it extends the quarantine period. If they don't get all their cattle in the pen, and those cattle are out there in the brush and won't come in, and ticks cycle on them, that can delay it. This is on infested and exposed, not adjacents and checks. Too many vacated premises. What that means is if people say, you know, I've got cattle here, but I'm kind of tired of this. I want to get them dipped out and move them to my place over in another county and just not mess with this. I'll bring them back when y'all are done. If that happens too much and we have too many question marks on the map at the end of the quarantine period, it's not going to be released. We've got to be sure that we've cleaned up ticks on the premises where we know they're at, and that they haven't spread to other premises. And of course, if we do discover a new infestation, say in March, April, May, when some of these incubating or dormant eggs hatch and larvae get on cattle. We may have inspected a herd last week that was clean, but there's eggs laying out there that just haven't hatched yet. So we may have some more of these pop up in the late spring that haven't become apparent yet. So that can delay a little bit that 12 to 15 month timeline. So if you're under quarantine, what can you expect? And I think these are some important things to think about. So right now, we're in what we call the initial inspection phase, okay? That's what's happening right now. And so the main goal right now is to get everybody identified and quarantined as quickly as possible with the intent of stopping movement of animals. Because if there's an infestation out there, we don't want it to spread any further to any other places. And then our goal is to inspect all the livestock on those premises as quickly as we can to determine the extent of spread that we have currently. We want to know, are our quarantine lines correct? Do we need to move them? Do we need to expand? Have we taken in a big enough area? We don't know how long these ticks have been here. We don't know how far they've been spread. So before you can really get started fixing the problem, you got to define it. And that's what we're trying to do right now. So right now we're in the initial inspection phase. This can be frustrating for ranchers because we don't have all the people in place yet to give you service, to assign an inspector to you. We have to bring in people, rotate in people from USDA, from other regions of the state to help with this. So you may have one person spraying your horse today and a different one spraying it in 2 weeks. That's a temporary situation, but that's during the initial inspection phase. So to try to give you one point of contact, right now, all requests for any inspections or treatments, dipping cattle out, hey, come do my initial inspection, etc., go through Dexter Sumter right back there so that you have one point of contact. And then he gets his guys lined out and headed the right direction to do the work. Once we complete the initial inspection phase, and just so y'all know, in the Live Oak current quarantine area where we're at right now, we have about 265 premises identified and quarantined. Of those, we have about 140 with livestock. We're about 50% of the way through the initial inspection phase. About 70 herds have been inspected. And so that's where we're at in the process. There's a little over 4,000 head of cattle in the quarantine area and almost 300 horses. Once we complete the initial inspection phase, we'll settle into the systematic inspection phase. So at that point, hopefully we'll have some inspectors hired dedicated to just this area. We'll probably split it up into geographical areas. We'll have a single livestock inspector assigned to an area of that. So from that point on, throughout the rest of the quarantine period, you'll have one point of contact for your herd work or dipping cattle out or getting a horse sprayed or getting a deer hide scratched. It'll simplify things a lot from your standpoint, and it'll always be the same person working with you. So that's coming. So during that phase of the quarantine period, our goal is, with those scratching your cattle or inspecting them every 90 days, is to detect a new infestation as soon as possible. So if those little larvae are on the cattle, we're not going to find those. But if we come out in 90 days and now there's adult ticks on there, we're going to find those, get started cleaning up that pasture. Like I said, there could be eggs laying out there right now that haven't even hatched that aren't going to become apparent until April. We want to find them as soon as possible. What we want to avoid is we come scratch your cattle today and they're clean. We don't come scratch them again for 6 months and they're really ticky, heavy. And by then it's also spread to about three or four neighbors. Now the problem has become really complicated. So our goal is to try and scratch them every 90 days, but I also rely on y'all that if it's only been 45 days since we scratched them and you're out there feeding your cattle and you see a bunch of ticks hanging off of them, call us. We don't have to wait 90 days. It's better to get started eradicating them from a pasture soon than late, and that's going to lessen the chances that they've spread to other places. And the owner or the rancher, the expense that they bear is presenting the cattle for inspection. And sometimes that's a relatively minor issue. Some people that have gentle cattle, cake broke cattle, good pens, not rough country. I've seen them go through a 16-month quarantine period and it cost them probably a grand total of 5 sacks of cubes and it wasn't very stressful. As y'all know, that's usually not the case. So it can be difficult. I mean, if you're having to hire a couple of cowboys and a helicopter, you know, even on some places that aren't huge, people still have to do that. It can become pretty costly to get the cattle in the pen. And I sure do understand that, but that is the only cost. Some people ask us, what do you charge to dip, or what do you charge to come, you know, scratch them? And we don't, obviously we don't charge anything for that. The rancher's expense is to put the cattle in the pen. So the initial inspection, what happens when we do that? First of all, it's necessary to try and determine the likely fever tick status of the pasture. And we want to do that before we start letting you move animals, okay? So if you need to sell something anytime soon and you haven't had an initial herd inspection, you need to holler at Dexter. Because what we don't want to do is have you haul 3 calves up to the vat. We scratch them clean. They go through the vat and they leave. They go out to the country somewhere. Next week, we go to do your initial herd inspection on the rest of the cattle, and they're 75% infested. We just took a big risk moving those calves off, even though they were dipped. There's a few more treatments that need to happen to move cattle off of an infested premises. And the reason for that is when you know you have fever ticks on cattle, there are times when they molt from that little larvae into a nymph. They kind of shed their skin like a snake, and the corral may not kill them. And so if they're coming off of an infested premises, we like to scratch them clean and dip them a couple of times before they go off there. So that's why we want to get an initial inspection on the herd prior to moving cattle. Now, once we've done that and you've scratched clean, at that point, anytime you need to move something, from now until your next 90-day inspection, you just call Dexter, or at some point it'll be your inspector. I'm going to haul some calves up to the vat Wednesday morning at 10. No problem. We'll be there. We'll dip them out for you. And that's the way that that works. So we'll show up with what we call a scratching chute. Y'all may have seen it. It's basically a long chute on wheels, elevates the cattle just a little bit. You can fit three or four in there depending on how big they are. And we will inspect them for ticks, and we'll also put in RFID tags. If y'all ever had any brucellosis testing done, we used to put in the silver metal tags when we would do that. Well, when we scratch cattle, that's the same thing as testing an animal. We're testing them for ticks. We were testing those for brucellosis. We're testing these for ticks. Instead of using those metal tags, we've made some progress. We use the RFID tags now. That way we're not bending over in the chute in bad daylight trying to read a rusty tag 3 years from now. We can use that little wand and just reach over and scan it, and it shows up on our little handheld. So it's a much better way to do those things. We might bring a spray box. If you're one of those adjacent premises right next to an infestation, when we show up to do your initial inspection, we're probably going to bring a spray box, because there's a higher likelihood that we may find ticks on that premises, say than one way out here on the edge. And so what we don't want to do is run 100 head through the scratch and shoot, turn them out in the pasture, and the last one comes through and we find ticks on it. I really wished I would have treated them then. So it's kind of a just-in-case thing. We hope we get to the end of that deal and we don't find any, but if we did find some, no problem. We already gave them their first treatment, okay? And then I mentioned earlier about hand spraying show cattle or horses, things that are halter broken gentle. There is something called a 14-day pass, and if it ties back to the life cycle of the fever tick again. People who have horses here that they use to day work on multiple premises, in and out of the quarantine area, all over the place. They're taking show cattle to prospect shows and coming back onto a quarantine premises, moving in and out. A lot of movement in and out for horses or show cattle that are halter broke. We just spray those every 14 days, and they can come and go as they want. Because if you think about it, any fever tick larvae that attach to them, as long as we're spraying them every 14 days, none of those are ever going to complete their life cycle, drop off and lay eggs. And a fever tick won't jump off as a nymph and jump onto something else. They don't do that. Remember, it's a one-host tick. Whoever they start with, that's who they finish with. So it's a pretty safe way to allow movement in and out on those types of animals without risking spreading ticks. So what is the significance, the importance of livestock on these premises? It's different whether you're infested or exposed. Are we at the beginning of the time frame, or are we towards the end of the time frame? The importance that I place on the livestock on the premises depends on what we're dealing with. So on an infested or an exposed, for the first 6 to 9 months, those livestock are a tool to clean up ticks. We're treating them systematically, okay? But then we stop treating. Remember, they go to a check premises for 6 months. At that point, they go from being a tool to being a sentinel. I tried to clean up ticks for 6 to 9 months, now I got to prove I cleaned them up. The only way to do that is leave hosts on the environment. Don't treat them. We want them to be good sentinels. If there's fever ticks out there, we need to know, okay? So we turn the cattle out there, 3 months, we get them up. If they're clean, that's promising. Another 3 months, if they come up, they're clean. You've eradicated ticks off that premises. So for the first 6 to 9 months, they're a tool. The last 6 months, they go to being a sentinel to show us the status of the premises, to make sure we prove that we clean ticks up. Now, if you're an adjacent or a check premises out here, we've done your initial inspection and you're clean. You're a sentinel. During the first phase, You're a sentinel to determine the current extent of the spread. Do we have our lines right? How far has it spread? During the next phase, you're still a sentinel, because if there's a new infestation, we want to detect it as soon as possible, okay? And this is key down here. Anything that affects the sentinel value of your livestock impedes successful eradication efforts in the free area. So this is treatment prior to inspection. So the whole point of this in the first part is to determine how far has it spread so we've got our boundary lines right. So if we go inspect four premises in a row all the way out to the edge and they're all clean, we feel pretty good about our line. But if all those guys treated their cattle 2 weeks ago because they saw ticks on them, and we don't know that, we may have our line in completely the wrong place. There may be ticks behind us that we don't know about. And we're focused over here trying to get these cleaned up when there's a fire burning out here, okay? So in the overall scheme of things and in the long term, anything that affects the sentinel value of the cattle impedes the success of eradication. So I would ask that prior to inspection, please don't treat your animals with anything that may mask the presence of cattle fever ticks on the pasture. You're welcome to treat them while we're scratching them. In fact, if you need to vaccinate, palpate, dehorn, brand, do whatever, deworm, that's fine, because it's going to be 90 days before we come back to you. And anything you've given them is probably not going to be affecting their sentinel value 90 days from now. But if you know we're coming out to scratch them next week, so you use out there and spray them with some stuff to get them cleaned up, you can clean the cattle up. Have you eradicated the ticks on the premises? No, your pasture's still infested. So deer are probably still picking those larvae up, spreading them, doing all those things. It may be 90 days from now when we go check your neighbor, all of a sudden they're ticky, and the whole time you were, but we didn't know it. So that's really important. I know it's instinct, it's human nature, And that's everybody's first reaction, is to want to find something to treat their cattle with to get the ticks off. But it really does impede the success of eradicating them in an area. So the reason, part of the reason I make this point as well is talking about the fever tick vaccine. That's something that's 45% effective against the particular fever tick that we're dealing with here. So in the permanent quarantine zone along the river, which is where we're using it, it's very appropriate because you're constantly having fever ticks come in from Mexico. That's not going to go away. And so if you can vaccinate all the cattle and their residents, and they'll be there forever, forever. It's permanent quarantine zone. And so that efficacy is going to build over time. What it does is it makes a more effective buffer zone. Because if you can decrease the amount of ticks in the buffer zone by 40, 50, 60%, you're decreasing the chances that wildlife in the buffer zone are going to carry it out into the free zone. It makes it a more effective buffer zone, but you've got constant influx of ticks, and you will have until Mexico does something. If we used a product like that here, I said how important it was for the cattle to be good sentinels. We need to have a very good idea of what the extent of spread is so we can get it cleaned up, done, walk away, move on, go back to normal life. So on some of these premises where we've only found one tick or two ticks, if those cattle had been given a product that's long-lasting like a vaccine that only kills 45% of the ticks, they're not eradicating ticks from the pasture, but it definitely could cover up or affect their sentinel value, if that makes sense. So we have a false sense of security that this area is clean when in fact it's not. And so hopefully they'll improve that vaccine. Hopefully there'll be adjustments made where maybe it is an effective tool to use in an area like this. But once we leave this area, there's no permanent controls in place. We need to be very confident we haven't left fever ticks behind, or we'd be right back in the same mess. So I'm sorry this has taken so long. I know y'all are getting sleepy, I appreciate it. This is a real quick summary of where we're at here in Live Oak County. So on November 28th, a rancher called a private veterinarian, had some problems with his animals. He came out, inspected them. He found a heavy, heavy tick burden on these animals, brought some of these ticks to our livestock inspector at the market, and they were identified as cattle fever ticks. The next day, he got the cattle in the pen, had his first treatment, 80 head, very heavily infested, very heavy infestation. So We went out 2 miles and put our quarantine line in place. Why do we go 2 miles from each fence line of an infested premises? The biologists tell us that's the average distance a white-tailed buck in rut will travel. So that's the basis of a 2 mile circle. Since deer would be the primary way that these ticks get spread from one property to another. So we went out 2 miles. We began our initial herd inspections on December 1st. And luckily we had good sentinel value on these cattle and discovered an additional 7 premises with cattle fever ticks. So we're currently up to 8 infested premises here and 2 exposed premises here. And we adjusted the quarantine lines each time. You find a new one, you go out 2 miles from that. You find a new one, you go out 2 miles from that. So that's why y'all may have seen these signs moving, sometimes what seemed like on a daily basis. It was in one spot when you went to work, it was in a different spot when you got back. And that obviously it meant we found another infestation and had to move the line. So whenever we do find an infestation, we don't know how long the ticks have been there. One thing that we do is we go back and look at anything they purchased for the last year. See if we can try to determine a source. That's important. If there's another infestation out there that we don't know about, it's important to find that and get it cleaned up. We also look at anything that they've sold or moved off the property for the last year. Because if the ticks were there 3 months ago and they sold cattle, didn't do anything wrong, they didn't know they had cattle fever ticks, but they could have potentially spread them to other areas. So that's called trace ins and trace outs. What we also do is we'll go and inspect any other herds owned or managed by that same person. What we found is other herds owned or managed tend to also have a higher risk of becoming infested. Most people move animals back and forth between multiple premises that they own or lease. And so that's some of the reason why some of these quarantine areas look a little funky. It's not all just been spread. Some of it has been some of those other premises owned or managed or movement of animals that we follow up on. One of the other things, I'll just mention it, that we do to try to find the source is genetics on these ticks. So it's not real specific like a fingerprint, but what it is, we currently have an outbreak in Cameron and Willacy County, and that population of ticks in that outbreak kind of has a genetic signature. We also have an outbreak in Hidalgo County and Starr County and Zapata County. And then we took the ticks here and sent them off for genetic analysis. Sometimes that will help trace it back or tie it back to a certain area. Because most of those are just different enough to tell that they're ticks that came from the Cameron-Willacy outbreak. And usually that's going to correlate to the genetics of the ticks in Mexico right across the border from them. There's some variability. Mexico uses a lot of different pesticides. At low levels, at different times, they don't treat systematically, and so you get some changes in the genetics of the ticks, and unfortunately you get a lot of pesticide resistance from the ticks. Kind of like if you don't take all your antibiotics and you stop taking them, you can get some resistant bugs. Well, that's kind of what Mexico does with these ticks, and that's another challenge that we have, is sometimes we get some pesticide resistant ticks that are hard to kill. So I think we've got a partial genetics back that it doesn't match the Cameron-Willacy ticks or Hidalgo ticks, but still waiting to hear on it. So sometimes that can help narrow it down to an area so we can try and figure out where it came from so that we can go back to that place and try to address those ticks. So there's the current map. You know, we kind of started out over in here, and as we found new ones and went out 2 miles from each fence line, this is where we're currently at. We haven't had any significant change in the last 2 weeks, which is promising. I don't want to get too far ahead of ourselves because, again, think back. You could have a tick laying out there that hasn't laid eggs yet, eggs that haven't hatched, or larvae that haven't crawled on an animal. Or you could have premises with no cattle on them that we're not able to scratch anything on. We're not able to determine the status of the premises. So what do you do on those premises with no cattle? Well, that's why we try to scratch every deer hide we can get our hands on. We encourage people that don't have cattle or livestock on there to harvest as many deer as you can, because we need to get an idea or a read on this pasture, and let us scratch those deer hides. So it's a challenge to answer all those question marks on every property in a quarantine area, but we're going to do our best. So here's a map of the quarantine zone. Everywhere you see a red star is an infested premises in the permanent quarantine zone. Everywhere you see a green one is an infested premises outside in the free area. This is pretty common down here. This is Zapata County. So you have a constant influx of ticks coming in on deer from Mexico. So you get infestations all the time. And sure enough, deer will carry them across that line into the free area pretty commonly. But they get to work on them, they get them cleaned up, they get them pushed back to Mexico, start all over. It's a never-ending process. So this is not uncommon to see. They're creeping right across the quarantine zone into the free area, even up here. Now look down here. It becomes challenging when you get a significant number of wildlife involved, especially nilgai. These have gone all the way from Mexico up to Port Mansfield in a year and a half to 2 years, 41 miles. There's a lot of nilgai there. They travel further than white-tailed deer, and they're very good hosts for cattle fever ticks. They don't come to a deer feeder and eat Ivermectin-treated corn. We don't really have an effective treatment for them. So that's one of the things that Agricultural Research Services at Moorfield is working on for us. More solutions for the nilgai problem in Southeast Texas. And then you see us way up here, very far north. So, but this is what can happen. If you have too many, they have a lot of vacated premises there with a lot of wildlife. They have probably more land with no cattle on it than they have with cattle on it, and a high density of wildlife that's basically untreatable, nilgai. And so in that instance, you don't have tools, your cattle, to mop up ticks, but you've got good hosts in nilgai cycling them and traveling long distances, and that's what you get, very extensive spread. That's just a little perspective. That's a close-up map. Here's the Rio Grande. Here's Port Mansfield up here, and fever ticks have spread 41 miles. So that's what can happen. So that's part of the importance here. I say that because everybody within this area plays a part in this. The more herds of cattle we keep on these properties, and the less we do to affect their sentinel value, the quicker we'll pick up an infestation and be able to appropriately eradicate it and avoid the scenario. That's the whole goal. Define it, get it cleaned up, and then and prove we cleaned it up, and then leave. So final points. I have Darren here this evening. Where are you, Darren? He's still over there with Farm Service Agency. They do have a program under the Emergency Livestock Assistance Program that has to do with the cattle fever tick program. So it is a financial aid program basically to help reimburse with some of the qualifying costs associated with some of these quarantines. So he's your point of contact here for this area. If you're under quarantine and you're that guy that it takes a helicopter and three cowboys to get your cattle in the pen, sometimes those payments are just tied to treatments related to cattle and not just gathering. It was basically designed in the beginning more to help those guys under an infested and an exposed quarantine, having to pin their cattle every 14 days to dip them. And so, you know, but it is a program that's out there. So you can visit with him. He can look at your type of quarantine, figure out if you qualify, and explain the steps to get signed up for that. That can be helpful over the long haul. Also, NRCS. Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
Days from when they're sprayed or treated, visit my office.
Okay.
Very critical. If y'all looking for assistance from my office, you have 30 days.
30 days from a treatment?
Yes.
Yeah, bring your paper from that y'all will give them.
A copy of your quarantine.
A copy of your quarantine, and you have 30 days from the date that you were treated. You have to be treated.
Okay.
Come into the office, and it's a simple form that you'll sign, and there'll be a few other things you have to do with it, but that assistance is good.
So for all of you guys that crumpled up your quarantine and threw it in the trash the minute we left, just call my office, I'll get you another copy. So NRCS also, they help with things like cross-fencing, brush control. Sometimes it's hard to gather cattle out of a pasture and a simple cross-fence is all you need. Or some brush control, a sendero, something like that. NRCS has a program to help with this also. I put on there, consider adjusting your business model if possible. I've seen guys at the beginning that had some snorty cattle, and it was going to be hell on them for the next 16 months. And what they did, they got all their cattle in the pen the first time, they scratched clean, and they moved them out. Now they had another lease place over in another county or something. They came back in there with some cake broke yearlings or something like that, and it made it much less stressful on them for the next 16 months of the quarantine period. So if it's possible, it's something to consider. For some people, it's not. This is your one place, it's all you got, and these are the cattle you got. And I understand that, but it's something to think about strategically. Your best shot to get all your cattle in the pen is usually the first time. They're usually a little more challenged 90 days from now. And then the third time, it sometimes can be a little more difficult. Like I said, if they're gentle cake broke cattle, generally they don't mind being scratched and going through the chute. But it's something to think about if you're in that situation. Please try and stay current on inspections. It ends up damaging yourself and everybody else. If it's going beyond 90 days, and I know everybody's busy and has a job and has a life, and believe me, 90 days will roll around quicker than you think. You'll think, we just worked the cattle. It was yesterday. No, it was 3 months ago. It comes around quicker than you think. But if it drags out there and we don't finally get the cattle in the pen till 5 months and they're heavily infested, and now three neighbors are infested, it makes things more challenging. Again, it impedes the eradication efforts overall. Just maintain communication with your inspector. Right now that's Dexter. Pretty soon you'll have an assigned inspector that you just maintain open communication with them. If you're having challenges, if you need us to bring some panels over, we have portable corrals, okay corrals. If you've got bad pens, we've got a squeeze chute. We can help. I can do a lot to help just short of coming out there horseback and pinning your cattle myself. And I don't have a helicopter. So help each other also. A community problem. Some of you guys, are good hands. You've got some good horses. You might have an elderly neighbor. Maybe his pens aren't that good. I mean, really, to get out of this, you got to pull together and everybody's got to help each other. That's the only way that it works. That's a good link right there. I'll just leave that up there. There is an economic impact study done by Texas A&M. What would be the cost of not doing anything or not doing what we're doing? And it's into the tens of billions as far as the impact on the economy here in Texas. So it's not only if you have cattle, but that's intertwined in the entire agriculture industry and all the industries that support that. And the economic impact of an expanded fever tick range, again, is huge. I know it's very burdensome, the process we're going through here in the short term, but there's a good reason for it. And just so y'all know, the dipping vat is now open. So if you've had your initial inspection and you scratched clean, if you need to move something, you just call Dexter, set up a time, bring your cattle to the dipping vat. We'll scratch and dip them there and you can go wherever. It is a public vat. Some people, I think, thought that if you go dip cattle there, you got to take them to the sale barn there just because it's located next to it. It's not. It's a public vat. It's a county vat. You can come in off of County Road 455 and pull in there, back up, unload the cattle. We'll scratch them, dip them, get them loaded back on the trailer, write you a permit called a Form A, said they've been inspected, they're clean, they've been treated, and they're good to go, and you can take them wherever you want. So, I want to thank the county. To have that thing up and going and dipping cattle in a month is miraculous, miraculous. Generally, 6 months minimum, I mean, to get something like that going, just outstanding job that they did. It makes you moving your cattle a lot easier than having to wait on when we can send someone out with a spray box to run them through there. So they did a great job. So that's open and ready to go. So just holler at Dexter if you've had your initial inspection. If you haven't and you need to get it done, call him too. So I'll just leave that up there. I know this went a long time and I appreciate y'all's patience. Again, if y'all have any questions for clarification on something on here, let's do that. If you have a specific scenario or something or a complaint or something that you want to discuss, let's just do that one-on-one after we're done.